So we continue with our discussion on MIDS-PSK modulation and demodulation. In fact, we discussed about the modulation technique briefly in the last class. Today we'll have a general idea about the demodulator structure, again briefly, to make a compromise. And then we'll switch over to another modulation scheme, the quadrature amplitude modulation scheme, and we'll have a brief discussion of that. The purpose of our discussion is that along with this discussion, you'll also read a little bit so that you know a little bit more about the modulation demodulation scheme. We have discussed in some detail the basic modulation schemes of BPSK, QPSK. Okay, so the subsequent discussions hence is a bit brief in nature, and you should be able to appreciate that clearly. So here is a diagram for the MIDS-PSK demodulator, a general one, and as you can guess very well, this is again, as is understood, is the structure for a coherent demodulator. Okay. Coherent demodulator structure, which implies that we need to recover the basis functions or the carriers, okay, appropriately in the receiver, and they are used explicitly for demodulating the received signal and get back the data sequence. Okay, so as usual, RT is my received signal, IF, okay, and it is fed to two multipliers where the signal is multiplied by the basis functions phi 1t and phi 2t, okay, and then we're integrating over the symbol duration, which is k times tb for MIDS-PSK in general, where m is equal to 2 to the power k, and the integrator outputs, they are sampled at an interval of t or one symbol duration, and the sampled outputs, which are scalars, okay, they're fed to this. Here is a difference, okay, and they are fed to this is one of the possible structures, really, what I'm calling as a phase discriminator. Okay, in this portion of the demodulator, we would like to have an assessment of what is the angle of the corresponding received vector r bar. We have received r t over the interval 0 to capital T. So here we get r bar, the received vector, and the r bar is consisting of r1, r2, the various components, and this structure fits well for this MIDS-PSK scheme, because if you just briefly look at the corresponding signal constellation diagram, we can see that a point is distinguished from another point through the angle, isn't it? The signal points are separated by an angle of pi by 4, okay, and the information lies in the angle that it subtends, really. So if I can find the corresponding angle, I get to know which signal point was transmitted. So that's the basic idea. And so I can say it is equivalently a phase discriminator, where what we have to do is that we have to find tan inverse of RQ and RI. You can see that this is a kind of deviation from the classical correlation receiver structure, okay, but it can be proved. I am not doing that, that this is equivalent to that basically. What I have shown earlier, even at least for QPSK, is that this RI and RQ, they are not unknown things really. In fact, we can decompose them in terms of the components of the received signal vector R, really. Okay, so because this modulation scheme is so clear in terms of the angle in the phase in the constellation diagram, so this is one obvious approach of getting an estimate of the angle of the received vector. Okay, and once I know this angle, I can map it. I can use a mapping table or a lookup table finding the angle. So there are 8 possible angles. So for each angle, I can store in a small table, okay, what are the corresponding bit sequence, okay, and what is the corresponding group of k bits, really, and I can give them out in a serial form at this end, really. Does it make sense? Yeah. Right.
Can be one of many values, because
right.
So for each value, you have to have a corresponding thing in the lookup table.
No, not really. In fact, there is an amount of decision making here. See. See, when I use the constellation diagram fully, for the at the moment I assume that the receipt basis functions, they have been receipt carriers have been acquired properly, that's ideal really, and if these are the signal points, then what I can expect is that the angle subtended by the receipt vector may be somewhere here, and the angle subtended will be something else than pi by 4, okay, and then I also know the decision zone really. I know that the decision zone for this signal point S2 bar is between 22 and half, isn't it, and this line, isn't it, 67 and half really. So if the angle, calculated angle is within that range really, I know that the corresponding transmitted vector most probably was S2 bar. So along with the lookup table, I also maintain the corresponding decision zone, which are very clearly defined by these lines.
Can we do this job with the control factor?
Pardon?
This approximation to the closest values at least within the quantity.
Yeah, you can do that. You can do that really. Okay. So implementation you can do in many ways really. Okay. Depending on the speed of processing that is necessary. Yes, you can do that. Okay. So this is a general structure of the demodulator. In fact, this can be applied for 8-point PSK, this can also be applied for 16-point PSK. Now let me ask, can I use this technique also for demodulating a QPSK modulated signal?
Yes.
Answer is yes, why not? Isn't it? Okay. Yeah. Can't see this? It's not there. I hope this page comes up. Well, did you could you see it earlier? Now it has come. That's nice. Thank you. Well, to remind you that this RI and RQ components, okay, the one that we'll get here in this IQ demodulator structure, I can call this demodulator structure again as an IQ demodulator structure. Like I gave a name to the modulator as IQ modulator structure. Okay, so following this IQ demodulator structure, just to remind you, this RI is root e cos 2 pi I by m, which is the low frequency component, data dependent component, plus wi, okay, where wi is a random variable, Gaussian random variable, which is the integrated version of the noise process, okay, that we'll get in the I path. Similarly, rq is minus root e sine 2 pi I by m plus wq, where wq is an identically distributed Gaussian random variable, okay, sorry. So these are RI and RQ really. Okay, a crucial point here, let me mention about this. We discussed in the last class that the basic motivation for choosing an MRE PSK scheme with large value of M, like 16, 32 and even higher, as high as even 256 point PSK, the basic motivation is to save transmission bandwidth, okay, while maintaining the very high data throughput. That means when the input data rate is very high and you have got a very narrow transmission bandwidth to transmit this data, you may choose this MRE PSK modulation scheme. Okay, but then it is very, very important that we get this 5-1-T and 5-2-T in the receiver very appropriately. And what does it mean? It means that the carrier recovery scheme in the receiver must be very robust so that we get a very accurate estimate of the carrier phase, instantaneous phase, okay, any phase offset as well as phase change because of noise and other uncertainties, that must be estimated very precisely so that we get 5-1-T and 5-2-T very accurately, okay. Any inaccuracy there, it will reflect in the output and the symbol error rate will not be optimum really, will not be the lowest possible one. So that is the critical part in the design of this kind of MRE PSK demodulator or receiver, okay. We now go to the next modulation scheme of quadrature amplitude modulation, QAM. What does this name imply? If anybody can guess,
four amplitudes.
Okay, yes, good guess. Anything else?
This is a kind of amplitude modulation. theta rather than phase.
Okay. Okay. In fact, in a sense, I mean, the name is a bit misleading. I could guess his point really. Seeing quadrature here, he could guess that, okay, there will be four signal points, isn't it? And the modulation may be in the amplitude as it is given here, as he has guessed correctly. But the point is that actually it is a kind of amplitude modulation scheme where the number of signal points need not be four. It may be much higher even. And the quadrature here, this word primarily means that it is a kind of quadrature modulation demodulation scheme. That means this IQ modulation demodulation kind of structure. Okay, the quadrature here actually stands for IQ, in-phase quadrature modulation, in-phase quadrature demodulation structure, where the basic modulation is in terms of amplitude variation. Is that okay? Well, so one important feature is that the carrier undergoes amplitude and phase modulations. In fact, there is another class of digital modulation scheme which I have not discussed. Is a digital amplitude modulation scheme. In fact, if you remember, we have also not discussed about ASK, amplitude shift keying. Okay. Again, I request you to read a little bit on that really. I thought we would discuss more other modulation schemes which are more useful in practice in other sense really. In this quadrature amplitude modulation scheme, a signal point will convey information, that is the information of the data sequence or the information associated with a symbol, okay, both in amplitude as well as phase. Okay, though in some special cases there may not be as much information in the phase, but information must definitely be conveyed through the amplitude. Okay, and the general expression for the signal SIT, time limited signal, I'm talking about SIT, which is an energy signal for converting the symbols to signals. Those SITs are of this form, root 2 E naught by T AI. You can see that instead of E, I am putting A naught. AI is some scaling function which is data dependent, times cos omega CT or 2 phi f CT plus root 2 E naught by T times BI, another scalar data dependent, sin 2 pi f CT. So the general structure is somewhat similar to earlier cases, but there are two subtle differences at least. One is that this, we had a constant like this earlier, isn't it? It was root 2 E by T naught. And in our earlier modulation schemes of PSK variety, because each signal point had same energy, so it was E flat. Okay. So we used to write it as root over 2 E by T. But here it is E naught, where E naught is the energy of the lowest amplitude signal, which clearly means that in this case of quadrature amplitude modulation scheme, all signal points will not have same energy, they will have different energies. The other difference is this AI and BIs, they are appropriate scalars, appropriate in the sense that they are dependent on data sequence, the data symbols really, okay, and they may assume different values, possible allowed values. The corresponding basis functions for defining this signal, energy signals, are phi 1 t and phi 2 t, they remain the same. Okay. So I can say quadrature amplitude modulation scheme again is a two-dimensional modulation scheme in the sense that two orthogonal basis functions or orthonormal basis functions are chosen again, and of the type same as that of PSK. Okay. And they are of this nature, root over 2 by t cos omega ct or sin omega ct. Okay. For using this modulation scheme, one has to ensure certain properties of the channel. I have put some question marks here. I will get back to this after some time. See, here is a sketch of a possible signal constellation. And this one is specifically for 16 QAM. So, how do you interpret this diagram? Two basis functions are phi 1 t and phi 2 t, okay, and then there are 16 signal points drawn in green, and you can see that they are regularly spaced here for practical reason, okay, and the energy contained by the signal points is not the same, isn't it? Like E naught, we can find here, this length is root over E naught, because this is the point nearest to the origin, zero energy point, okay. So, there will be some signal with a larger energy. In fact, if you think, if you just think a little bit, you will find that there will be three possible values of energy in this kind of constellation, in this specific constellation, isn't it? So, if I now quickly think about the corresponding correlation receiver structure, in our vector receiver structure, we have to subtract that half of Ek energy per symbol, okay? But still, we can use the correlation receiver structure. So, this is a possible signal constellation for 16 QAM. Would you like to suggest some other constellation pattern for the 16 points? If I just ask you at this moment, would it be possible to, yeah, well, so one suggestion is that I rotate it by some fixed angle, any fixed angle, constant angle of phi, let me write it as theta, some chosen angle. Even then the constellation remains the same and it is the same 16 QAM. Is that okay? Okay. Any other radical change in the signal constellation? Yeah. So, that's a good suggestion. Okay. What is that? Well, we would like to have the points on two concentric circles. Pardon? So that the number of energy levels is 2, isn't it? Now, how many points would you like to allocate on which circle, on these two circles? 8 each? 4 and 12. Okay. What is the reason for this specific choice? And what is the reason for his? I'm raising the point because I'm not able to discuss about the full theory. Pardon? Yeah.
It won't be equidistant, the point.
Well, equidistance on the circle. Is point understood? See, if we have 8 points on the smaller circle, his point probably is that, I mean, these points, I can place 8 points in a lower, smaller circle like this, and 8 points in the larger circle over there. Yeah, decision. Let me put the other 8 points like this, say, as a choice. Okay, that is one possible scheme. Now, he was talking about some distance. So, have I maintained the same distance? Sorry. for these points, they are equidistant. Okay, in fact, this constellation is same as 8 PSK, 8 level PSK, and for the outermost 8 points again, it is an 8 level PSK. Only thing is that their energy content is different, okay. But is it a case where the information is only in amplitude, not in phase? Because I have got two signal points with the same phase, you can see that, is it not? So, phase should not be used as a second criterion for distinguishing two points really. Yes, that is so in this case, but there are points here for which that is not valid. Here for all possible phase angles really, there are two points. That may be one idea, without disturbing the average, the overall average, overall power, transmission power or average energy per symbol, I can even rotate the one of the circles by some fixed amount. It will be purely phase, but the amplitude portion will also be there.
But that is always allowed in phase modulation.
Pardon?
It is allowed in phase modulation that the energy might be different.
So, his point is, it is allowed in phase modulation that the energies might be different, but that was not at least allowed for QPSK, BPSK and MRA PSK, the ones that we discussed, isn't it? But what he says is that he is trying to generalize, and I am for him really. My only idea, only suggestion is that don't think that whatever I am discussing are the only possibilities. Think freely, okay? Because then you will ask why it is not used practically. That will lead to the other kind of analysis, which I have to skip here, is that of some other parameter, which can be minimized by some regular choices of the signal points. Okay, what he says at this point is that even for a PSK phase modulation scheme or PSK, why is it necessary that all signal points have to have same energy? Okay, at least for MRE PSK, QPSK, BPSK, the ones that I described, I said the each energy, each signal point will have same energy. But if you relax that point, what you get is a class of modulation scheme which is known as APK, amplitude phase keyed modulation scheme. Okay, it's a combination of both. In fact, there is no restriction as why I cannot think of any combination. So what he says is that is a valid one where he rotates it, and it is not necessary that each signal point will have the same energy. So that is one modulation scheme. Only reason is that the signal point should be ultimately well chosen so that average energy ultimately is minimized, because ultimately we would like to transmit very reliably with minimum transmission power. Okay, so from that point of view, one should not arbitrarily go for APK if a corresponding regular signal constellation gives you the same performance. But there are situations, there are reasons when a general APK is chosen in preference to these regular signal constellations. Okay, so there are, my point here, coming back to this point, is that the signal constellation, even for given number of points such as 16, is not unique. Is not unique. Okay, it might be like this, it might be like this. Now there are finer issues really of which one is ultimately better. Okay, so at least keep this question in your mind when you go through some advanced courses. Come back to this with this question, and you will find that there are possible answers really. For example, one can even calculate by geometrically. If I assume that all these signal points are equally likely to occur, which is a very good assumption. In fact, we have been assuming that implicitly, that all these signals or all these symbols are equally likely at the input of my modulator, then this equally probable signal points, then I can find out the average energy per symbol. Is it not? Okay, and there we can see that these four corner points, they are having the maximum energy, isn't it? So one has to find out in terms of average energy whether this constellation is better compared to this constellation, where, just for a quick comparison, let me say that this distance is the maximum distance, which is R, okay, which is the root over square root of the energy content by this signal point. And if this distance is also R, then which constellation has got smaller average energy? Isn't it? That is a question to be asked. And we would like to, we would choose that constellation which has got smaller average energy. Okay? Then the other issue is, the other issue is that, well, the receiver structure. Okay, in the receiver structure, because here also we found that two points, they have got same angle and they can be distinguished only by amplitude. Here also we have a similar situation, but there are few points, in fact there are 8 such points, 50% of the signal points, where the phase is an important criterion. So would you like to make use of that in your receiver structure when you are worried about simplifying the hardware structure of the receiver? If you want to make use of that, maybe this signal constellation is better than this signal constellation point, because here for each angle you have got two points. So ultimately you have to take a decision based on the amplitude. Whereas here, at least for the 50% of the signal points, okay, phase also can be used, isn't it? It's 50% precisely. You have got two such points in each quadrant. Okay, this signal point is unique in terms of angle, in terms of energy as well, really. It's not same as this, it's not same as that. So you may like to use that as the basis of your receiver structure. So depending on what you are ultimately trying to gain, if you are trying to reduce the complexity of the receiver complexity as such increases with number of signal points. So if you want to reduce that complexity, contain it with a little bit of sacrifice in the error performance from the optimal performance criteria, then this kind of issues may come into picture. Okay. Otherwise, as I said earlier, that average energy per symbol should in any case be minimized. So with there are a few more points really, based on which a constellation is ultimately chosen for implementation. Yes.
Just to
difference in amplitude also, because there are
Yes, yes.
that's affecting the distribution. We have to design some structure in the
right
distribution. What is the amplitude?
See, it may be it need not be according to the decision. The decision need not be according to amplitude only, is my point. Like here, I can also take my final decision depend about a signal point based on amplitude as well as phase.
That will reduce the error, maybe.
And that's what is an ultimate aim.
But the receiver structure may be more complex because I have to maybe distribute.
This portion is not very clear. This portion is not very clear. In fact, there is a chance that in this process of the decoder structure, the demodulator structure which comes out may not be optimal one. Okay, but you may take advantage of some kind of hardware simplification. Okay, so it is not very clear at the moment. In fact, we are not going to that depth really. Okay, but in some cases it may be possible. It is again coupled to another issue. Let me talk about that at the moment really, is that of again carrier recovery. The basis functions, the cos omega ct term must be recovered very clearly for this modulation scheme as well really. Okay, and not only that, there is another very important issue, because the information this time goes in the amplitude of the signal. How do I expect my channel to behave, my modulation channel? Should it be linear or non-linear? Yes, yes. If you ever see that the channel may be non-linear, think twice before using this kind of modulation scheme. When the channel is known to be perfectly linear, this QM is a good one. Okay, QM is a good one. In fact, it may have smaller average energy per symbol compared to a 16-point PSK. Okay, so this may turn out to be a better scheme provided the channel is perfectly linear. If the channel is not linear, then this is not a good scheme that way. In fact, because of non-linearity, what may happen, can you guess from this signal constellation? We can have a quick guess. Suppose this is my signal point, signal constellation for a 16 QM level, and the signals are transmitted through a channel which has got some non-linearity, okay, whose input-output transfer characteristics is something like this in terms of power, say, okay. Yeah, that's the point. These outermost four points, they are more likely to get affected, is it not? So because of this nonlinearity, these points will tend to move inside, isn't it? If there is minor nonlinearity, if the nonlinearity is very prominent, then even these points may get affected. So the whole constellation may tend to squeeze, isn't it? And this lower energy signal points will not be affected that much. These signal points will get affected, and when this signal point, because of this nonlinearity, not because of noise but because of this nonlinear effect, they come inside, okay, they come closer to these signal points really, and you have more and more decision errors, okay, and hence the symbol error rate, average symbol error rate increases fast. So the modulation scheme is sensitive to any nonlinearity in the modulation channel, okay. Yeah, they are used in many cases. QAM, in fact, again, we can see that, pardon?
It would be used for wireless.
Many of the wireless channels are linear channels. Okay, so there is, but not, I'll tell you where they are not used. Like in satellite communication, they are not used. Because in satellite communication, the power amplifier on board the satellite, they are usually driven into this nonlinear region to extract more power from there really. So QAM is not at all a choice for satellite communications, okay, but there are channels really where over a short distance, okay, you may even go for a wireless communication link with a heavy data throughput, where the data transmission rate is very high, of the order of a few hundreds of megabits per second. But you have to transmit it over a short distance of a few kilometers, okay. And in that case, you can use this kind of 16 QAM or high number of points and QAM modulation, because the basic essence of MRE PSK is also here. We can see that by choosing 16 points or high number of points, we are reducing the symbol rate or increasing the symbol duration. So the transmission bandwidth needed will be smaller, okay, compared to QPSK, BPSK, or binary FSK. So over a smaller bandwidth, over a short distance, even the wireless channel will be linear and high throughput can be supported. Okay, there are some high data throughput point-to-point microwave links, okay, covering distances of a few kilometers, 5, 6, 7, 8, I mean usually not beyond 10 kilometers, where data can be transmitted over a large, I mean at a very high rate. I mean, for such channels, QAM is a good choice. Really.
Yes.
It's possible through this modulation scheme now.
If I have another bandwidth which is higher than this.
Another bandwidth.
Yeah.
Right?
Then I can have a throughput which is even better than
this. Yes. If you use the same modulation scheme. Isn't it? Okay. So now we are discussing about digital modulation scheme. Here the major issue is you have to choose the appropriate modulation scheme so that you can support the data rate even within a smaller bandwidth, and you can ensure the same performance in terms of error rate with a minimum energy per symbol. Okay. In fact, there are lot many variations. As another example, that's not perfectly of QAM really, that's more, that's closer to some PSK modulation, MRE PSK modulation with some changes in the signal constellation, which is also popular in what is known as DSL, digital subscriber line, okay, which is an American standard where very high data rate is supported through low quality lines really. That's not well line, well less one, that's a well line scheme. The signal constellation is so chosen that with minimum energy, high rate of throughput can be, high data rate can be supported there. So these multi-point signal constellations, they're very effective for modern modulation scheme, most recent modulation schemes where a lot of digital processing can be done conveniently. So QAM modulator structure, I have simplified it like this. Tell me if I'm wrong. Here I have accepted that name of serial to parallel conversion here for this block, okay. In fact, this is somewhat specific to this signal constellation of 16 points, okay. The idea is that from this input data stream, 4 bits will be considered together as one symbol. These 4 bits will be considered, 4 bits at a time, and for the 16 point scheme, 2 bits, as we are doing for the 16 PSK last time, say these 2 bits you may transfer to this I path, the next 2 bits you can transfer to this Q path, like that. Again, from the next symbol, the next 2 bits will go to this I path, the next 2 bits will go to this Q path in this sequence. Okay, so I can say for this 16 QAM, you will get a 2 bit sequence at a time. Okay, say 1 1 initially followed by 0 1, and here 0 1, and then like this 1 0, and these 2 bits at a time will be used to choose some level, amplitude level. If you get back to this signal constellation, okay, I am following the IQ modulator structure. Is that clear? This is the IQ modulator structure. Okay, so with the help of the signal constellation, I can say that the number of possible I values are how many? We'll get one I value corresponding to this length. We'll have another I value corresponding to this length. Isn't it? Similarly in the negative direction. Similarly for the Q values, amplitude values. So these 2 bits will be used for generating the amplitude level in the, for the I path, these 2 values will be used to generate an amplitude level in the Q path.
What is the input stream again?
Pardon?
The input stream.
The input stream is that from this incoming data sequence, serial data sequence, I group 4 bits together to call this as a symbol. Okay. So I have to generate one signal points for this group of 4 bits. Okay, so because this is a group of 4 bits, I may conveniently choose 2 bits, the first 2 bits to one path, I path, the next 2 bits to the Q path, and like that. Okay, So from the serial bit sequence, I just send 2 bits to the I path, 2 bits to the Q path, so that this I signal and Q signal, they are independent once again, okay. And then these 2 bits can be used to generate the appropriate level as per the signal constellation, okay. I multiply with the corresponding carrier, cos omega ct, sin omega ct, I get my corresponding. So this I may call as Ri, this is Rq, this is my modulated signal. It is adjusted here itself. When I generate the level, I take care of that scalar factor. Okay? So this is the structure of the modulator. Now, if I had 32 points in the signal constellation, then what would happen? Then I had to have a group of 5 bits together. Okay? And from these 5 bits, I had to generate the corresponding levels in the level generator. And in that case, the I and Q, Ri and Rq, they would not be independent. There would be dependence. Okay, this signal here, these 2 bits are independent of these 2 bits, but for 32 level, that means 2 to the power k, where k is an odd integer, there will be dependence in Ri and Rq really. Then you don't get the requisite number of amplitudes that have to be generated. Okay, think a little bit on that. Well, this is the demodulator structure. Yeah. In the constellation diagram, no, it depends on how many amplitudes have to be generated, how many kinds of amplitudes have to be generated, okay. Like, in fact, the signal constellation for 32 point would be somewhat different. I mean, it would appear like a cross, okay. That's one constellation which is preferred really. Cross in the sense that, let me outline, in fact, I'll mention about one more point here. The constellation diagram for 32 point would be something like this. Please check from a book that the 4 corner points are avoided to reduce the average energy per symbol or signal. Okay, the 32 points, they are here. Now, for those 32 points, if you find out the number of levels needed for in the I path or in the Q path is not 8. Okay. So, you have to generate certain number of levels, not 4, more than that really, so that you cannot really, the issue is that for 32 level QAM, you have to have a group of 5 bits at a time. Now, how do you separate these 5 bits? You cannot separate an integer number of bits here and integer number of bits here. If you take 3 bits here, you can generate 8 levels. All 8 levels are not necessary as per the constellation diagram. And if you send 3 bits here, you can send only 2 bits here, okay. This is again shorter than for generating the requisite number of levels. This is a general problem for an odd value of k, for 3, 5, 7, like that. So what is done, but that is not a very important issue. What you can do is that instead of calling it as a serial to parallel, you maintain a table here, in fact, for this whole thing, okay. So depending on the 5-bit pattern or 7-bit pattern, you give out the corresponding level values straight away. Okay, so that may be a more elegant approach really. That's what is usually followed. For this kind of generation, a simple lookup table is used, and ultimately a D2A converter somewhere is used, depending on how these multipliers are also implemented. Okay. Now one point, it's good that we came back to this point. See, this by these brown dotted lines, what did I indicate? The decision boundaries, okay, and then the decision zones. One single point is that you can see that here it is for the first time that the decision zones are not similar as it was for any PSK modulation scheme. We can see that the decision zone for or decision region for a point like this was only this much, very confined one, okay, whereas the decision zone for this point is open-ended on this side, is it not? Okay, so it implies, we'll actually not take up a detailed derivation of that really, it implies that derivation of an expression for the average symbol error rate or SER, okay, for this kind of modulation scheme, QA modulation scheme, is going to be somewhat different, somewhat complicated if I say that really, then derivation of an expression for symbol error rate for PSK kind of scheme, or where the decision regions were very similar looking. Here the decision regions are of two types. If you remember, for any PSK, FSK, the decision regions are very uniform, very similar. If I find the error rate for one region, I can find the error rate for the other region. Okay. Here that is not going to be the case really. So finding an expression for error rate, average error rate for QM kind of scheme is a bit more difficult, and in fact people go follow usually what is a kind of approximate expression for the symbol error rate, but we'll skip that altogether. Well, now this is a demodulator structure for QM. Is that okay? A conceptual one. Okay. So what is done is following the correlation receiver structure. Okay, and then this is a coherent demodulator structure. Once again, I am making use of the basis functions. The receive signal is taken in. I get the corresponding RI and RQ. Okay, and now if I look back at the corresponding modulator, I get an idea for that demodulator really. At the modulator, I had used a level generator. So RI and RQs were very specific levels. Okay, so what I do in the receiver is that I take this RI and RQ, pass them through a decision device where there will be multiple levels. Does it make sense? In case of BPSK or QPSK, we had a comparator in the simplest form, okay, which was a two level decision device, either this or that. This is a more general form of that, because my allowed value of corresponding SI in the modulator may be either this or this, maybe either this or this in the negative direction. So now I will find what is RI that I have received, and then if RI is here, closer here, I will allow, consider this has been the corresponding transmitted value really. Okay, so it is a kind of quantization, isn't it? So I use this multiple level decision device here and get the corresponding estimates, and from there I generate the binary sequence. Maybe I can use some kind of lookup table once again here. Yeah, the first two will come from here, the next two will come from there, before the next two comes is taken from here, and the same sequence is maintained. So summarily, QAM kind of modulation scheme is good when the channel is known to be linear, okay, and when we have to transmit high rate data over a rather narrow transmission bandwidth.
So what is the bandwidth analysis for this? How do we achieve that? Very high rate of data.
Pardon?
What is the bandwidth analysis?
Right. His point is, what is the bandwidth analysis for this kind of QM modulation scheme, isn't it? In fact, we will talk about the spectrum for all these modulation schemes that I am discussing now. Okay, first, now we are discussing about the basic scheme for modulation and demodulation. After this, we will talk about the corresponding error performance, and then we will talk about the corresponding spectrum of the modulated signals. Okay, fine.
Is the bandwidth for QM less than that of QPSK?
It would be same.
Same.
Sorry, QPSK, not QPSK, is it
16 point PSK.
Is it the same as
because it's the same, like T equal to
4
dB again.
T equal to
4
dB.
Right.
See, his approach is correct. Ultimately, the bandwidth of the modulated signal is primarily because of the changes in the symbol sequence. Okay, if I may say so, the symbol sequence basically. So the symbol sequence, whenever I've got a group of 4 bits in one symbol really, the rate of change of the symbol is smaller, okay? So that's going to essentially define my transmission bandwidth. But the actual shape of the spectrum is also dependent on how this symbol is actually taken in the form of signal energy, SIT is really. Is it not? To understand the point, you can just think that if I have a two-valued sequence, suppose I'm showing in two-dimensional signal space only, say I have chosen these 2 points for BPSK modulation, okay, and there is a certain bandwidth for the modulated signal. Now if I have 2 more points like this, does my spectrum change by how much? Let me repeat the question. First, I consider my binary PSK modulation scheme. So this is my signal constellation with two points. Okay. And the data rate is some RB. So one symbol, one bit is one symbol. Now I have added two more signal points here. Okay. Now my symbol rate is half of the data rate. Is it not? Two bits make one symbol. So what is the transmission bandwidth? Half of what it was earlier. Okay. What kind of modulation scheme it is? Now look at this constellation diagram. Is it PSK anymore? Give a name, try to give a name to this. It's not APK. Isn't it? I can say this is a kind of digital amplitude modulation. Digital because only few levels are allowed. Okay, but this ultimately amplitude modulation scheme really. Yes, a form of ASK, yes. Okay, so my point is that, so I'm allowing four possible amplitudes in both the directions, positive and negative, okay. So what happens is that the spectral shape does not change, but the width has become half only. Is it not?
Yes. So what you are saying is that 16 PSK and 16 QAM will have identical
That's because no, for between 16 QAM and 16 PSK, okay, both of them will support same data rate. Isn't it? The noise performance is going to matter. What is going to be different is the corresponding error performance, symbol error rate performance. We'll talk about that. Okay. It's time almost, isn't it? So we stop. Next day we discuss about, we go back to our correlator structure and try to find a general estimate of error, symbol error rate, and then we find the error rate for the specific modulations.
Can be used with